There have been more mass shootings in the U.S. than days this year. That's according to data from the Gun Violence Archive, a nonprofit organization which tracks mass shootings in the U.S. The organization says there have been 255 mass shootings in the U.S. this year. It defines a mass shooting as an incident where at least four people were shot, excluding the shooter. The data show more than 33,000 total shooting incidents in 2019, resulting in nearly 9,000 gun deaths as of Monday afternoon. The number of people in the El Paso massacre makes it one of the 10 deadliest shootings in modern American history and the deadliest of 2019. James Burnett joins me now from Charlottesville, Virginia. He's the editorial director for The Trace. It's an independent nonprofit news organization dedicated to covering gun violence in the U.S. James, thanks for being with us. You have covered gun violence for years now. Can you give us some context on mass shootings? How does it fit in with gun violence in the U.S. in general?
So mass shootings, such as the ones we just experienced in El Paso and Dayton, drive a ton of attention, a ton of public concern. Overall, they do represent about 1% of overall gun fatalities. And on top of fatalities, there are orders of magnitude more injuries. So it's really suicides that are the largest number of gun deaths, gun homicides, and then after that, domestic incidents and gun accidents. But for obvious reasons, the mass shootings command a lot of attention.
Well, most of the deadliest mass shootings have occurred within the last 10 years. What is behind the rise?
Well, I don't know that we have a definitive explanation, but one theory comes back to magazine capacity. So the ammunition that a gun can hold before the shooter has to reload. You see in many cases, whether it's a handgun, and actually handguns are used in more active shooting incidents than assault style rifles, but you can often see 30 or 40 rounds. In Dayton, the shooter was using a 100-round drum and was able to get off, I think, 41 shots, according to police there, before they were able to subdue him within 30 seconds. But when you can shoot that many rounds before reloading, obviously the casualty counts can be pretty high.
Well, President Trump called for a crackdown on violent video games and mental health reform. Do you agree with the president that changes in those two areas are needed to prevent gun violence?
Well, what we turn to at The Trace is what the research would say. And what the research says is that the U.S. does not have more mental illness than other countries. And in fact, it doesn't have more video game fans than other countries. If you look at other leading markets for video games, China, Japan, South Korea, a lot of video game fans, not the same levels of gun violence that we see. And same thing with mental health. The statistics say that people suffering from mental illness are more likely to inflict harm on themselves than others. And even among mass shooters, even among that limited category, the FBI was only able to find mental illness as a factor in 25% of cases when it did a big study. So I think certainly there's a place for a discussion of mental health when it comes to gun suicide, and certainly a policy discussion around mental health and the services provided in this country. But a serious conversation about gun violence reduction is not really a conversation about mental health.
Well, many gun control activists are seeking a ban on assault weapons to curb mass shootings. What do you make of that?
I think it's understandable that assault-style weapons become a focus after incidents like this country has just been through. What the data says may be the more determining factor is the magazine capacity, the number of rounds that a gun can fire before it has to be reloaded. And the research says that when the federal assault weapons ban was in place, that what that was doing was meaning that the magazine capacity was limited. And what we saw was fewer mass shootings and fewer fatalities from those mass shootings. It's a pretty limited data set, I should say. But that's where that conversation goes.
Well, President Trump and other lawmakers have called for red flag laws. Can you explain what they are and whether they have worked in states that have implemented them?
Sure. So when you're talking about gun laws, step one is who is eligible to allow to own a gun and who's banned because of some factor in their past history. But then there's the second question. Someone legally acquires a gun. They own it lawfully for some amount of time. But then begin to present an acute risk to themselves or others, clear warning signs. And what a red flag law does is it allows law enforcement, in some cases, family members, school officials, other members of the community, to petition a court to remove the guns from that person who is in crisis for a set period of time until the danger has passed. And so that's what a red flag law would do. And the federal standard would incentivize states to pass these. We did see a lot of states pass these on a bipartisan basis after Parkland. And it is one place where there does seem to be some bipartisan, a potential window, I guess, for bipartisan action.
All right. We'll wait to see if indeed any action is taken. James Burnett. James, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.